Heads up! You are in the Hoodwood. I'm the Black Bandit, KJ Green, welcoming you to Sports from the Hoodwood for August 30th, 2018. Coming up this week, Manu calls it a career. Is it the beginning of the end of the salad days in San Antonio? I have the picks and predicts for the NFL playoffs, who I think is getting to Atlanta in February. With MLB season and playoff system in need of a tune-up? Got all that, Phat Dap and Head Slap, and the introduction of the Hoodwood College Hot 5. Straight ahead on this edition of Sports from the Hoodwood. Are you ready? Let's go.
You're tuned in to Sports from the Hoodwood, the internet's foremost location for the most honest, unfiltered commentary and insight on the world of sports. Now, once again, here's Hoodwood's hometown hero, KJ Green.
Greetings from the Hoodwood, where even though the entity is getting global, it's still locally made and produced. I'm your man, KJ Green, welcoming you once again into the Hoodwood. And leading off this week, I know it's hard for me to talk about a team I'm not very fond of. I'm not a Spurs fan. It's a team I've never been a fan of, especially how the sports networks just seem to always seem to fawn over how they play the quote-unquote right way. You know, the perpetually grumpy Greg Popovich has been hailed as a basketball savant. And the Spurs have not missed the playoffs, can you believe this, since the 96-97 season. Princess Katie was still arm baby, and Princess Jazzy wasn't even thought of. I mean, that's how far back it's been since the Spurs last missed the playoffs. That was Pop's first season. He took over early in that season after Bob Hill stumbled the Spurs out to a 3-15 start. David Robinson was hurt, and they just kind of ground their way to a 20-62 mark, which I thought they were tanking purposefully to get Tim Duncan. Well, they did get Tim Duncan. They won the draft lottery in the spring of 97 and got the laconic Tim Duncan from Wake Forest. And with a healthy Robinson, they rebounded to a 56-win season in 98. And the next year, in the lockout strike shortened season of 99, won their first NBA title. And then the Spurs went on a run which, even by Lakers / Celtics standards, is pretty mind-blowing. 18 straight years of 50 or more wins. And I looked this up when I was doing research on this part of the show, and I was looking up the Spurs, and I'm thinking, they really have been one of the bedrock teams of the 21st century in the NBA, if not all sports to boot. Including the 2011-12 season, they won 50 of 66 games in that shortened season. So that run of 18 straight years of 50 more wins includes a season that didn't have an 82-game complement. Basically, the Spurs have been NBA royalty. But one of the key components of that run, in addition to Tim Duncan, David Robinson, playmaking guard Tony Parker, was Manu Ginobili. And he was drafted by the Spurs in 1999. Even though he came on the scene in 2002, he was actually a 99 draft choice of the Spurs as one of the last picks of the second round. Ginobili didn't even sign with the Spurs from Argentina until 2002, but he made his mark quickly. And of course, one of his signature moments was leading his Argentine squad to a stunning upset of the U.S. team in the 2004 Olympic Games in the semifinals. And then they did earned the goal a night later by knocking off Italy in the gold medal game. Now, Ginobili's Euro step was hard to defend, and his reckless bull charges to the basket were legendary. Now, Ginobili announced his retirement from basketball on Monday, and there is an argument if he should be a Hall of Famer. But consider this. You know, there are seven players that have won four titles and a gold medal. Olympic gold medal. All of them except Manu Ginobili and the Black Mamba, Kobe Bryant, are in the Hall of Fame. No one's denying Kobe Bryant is going to get the call from Springfield here soon. And I honestly think, as much as I don't like the Spurs and was no real big fan of Ginobili, I think he should get the call as well. So what does this mean for the Spurs? Now, I openly predicted that Pop was going to follow Tim Duncan out the door when he retired. But now you have three key components gone all at once. Kawhi Leonard being traded to Toronto, Tony Parker being traded off to Charlotte, and Ginobili retiring. Is this the end of the salad days in San Antonio? Now, consider that Pop is pushing 70. He'll turn 70 midway through this coming season. Do you really think he has the wherewithal to do a rebuild? In addition, keep in mind, he's also fronting USA Basketball. Do you think he might want to stay in San Antonio for a rebuild while trying to get an Olympic team ready for the 2020 Olympic Games? Now, the Spurs have found one international gem after another in the savvy team-building skills of general manager R.C. Buford is unquestioned and unparalleled. But the thing is this. Time is undefeated. And the special players that the Spurs have had over the last 20 years can't be replicated or duplicated. With Ginobili, I mean, honestly, the Spurs struggled. With Ginobili and Parker, they struggled to get 47 wins last year. And there's no knock against DeMar DeRozan. I think he's a fine player, but I don't think he can do it by himself. He's walking into a fading team. Now, with the West being super deep and teams like the Nuggets and the Lakers on the come up, holding a 7 seed that they had last year. Remember, they were a 7 seed last year with 47 wins. Holding that 7 seed is going to be tough. Don't be surprised if this is Pop's last year and the Spurs continue their fade into basketball irrelevance. Going to switch gears now and finish up the NFL playoff predictions. Who I think is going to Atlanta, where Super Bowl 53 will be held first Sunday in February. I've given you who I think will finish where in 2018. But the real juicy details are who I think will make the playoffs and how far they will get. Let's recap the conferences first. In the NFC, I have the NFC East finishing order as Philly, Dallas, the New York Giants, and Washington. In the NFC North, I have the Vikings, Packers, Lions, Bears in that order. NFC South, I have the Saints, Falcons, Panthers, and Bucks. And in the NFC West, I have the Rams, Niners, Seahawks, and Cardinals in that order. In the AFC, I have the Pats, Bills, Jets, and Dolphins. AFC North, I have the Steelers, Ravens, Bengals, and Browns. In the AFC South, I have it as the Jags, Texans, Titans, and Colts. And in the AFC West, I have the Chargers, Chiefs, Raiders, and Broncos. Now, switching back to the NFC, I have the Vikings and the Rams getting the byes as the top two seeds, with the Eagles and Saints facing the Packers and Falcons in the wild card round, respectively. I have the Falcons beating the Saints, the Eagles knocking out the Packers, Vikings beating the Falcons in the divisional round, and the Rams beating the Eagles. The Vikings will continue their long-time playoff dominance over the Rams. Rams finding out they have a hard time beating the Los Angeles Rams and beating the Vikings in the playoffs. The last time the Vikings made the Super Bowl, they beat the Los Angeles Rams in December of 1976. I think that they will finally get over the hump with Kirk Cousins leading to them to their first Super Bowl in 41 years. Now, in the AFC, I have the Patriots and Jags getting the byes, with the Chargers and Steelers facing the Chiefs and Texans, respectively, in the wild card round. The Chargers keep the Chiefs luckless in the playoffs, while the Steelers rout the Texans. The Patriots beat the road-weary Chargers, who have to come all the way east to play them in the cold, while the Jags continue to have the Steelers solve and beat them in the playoffs. Sorry, Steeler fans. But this time, the Jags will beat the Steelers in Jacksonville, and then the Jags will upset the Patriots in the AFC title game. Brady and Belichick will then both retire. I have the Jags and the Vikings squaring off in Atlanta, with the Vikings finally getting their first ever Super Bowl title. And when that happens, I will report to the Hoodwood in tears and probably be skipping work that Monday with a hangover from celebrating too much. I'm not a homer. I just think that the Vikings have the pieces in place to win their first NFL title. We will step aside for a timeout, and when we come back, we will discuss if a shakeup is really needed in Major League Baseball. Sports from the Hoodwood will return after this timeout.
You're tuned into Sports from the Hoodwood, the internet's foremost location for the most honest insight and opinion on the world of sports. Now, once again, here's the man of the hour after hours, your host, KJ Green.
You are back in the Hoodwood. I'm your man, KJ Green, and I have to preface this segment with a statement. I love baseball. It's my first sport. First game I ever really learned, first sporting event I ever went to was a baseball game with my mom, who taught me how to throw a baseball. The reason I'm left-handed throwing is because I mimicked her. And baseball was the first sport growing up that I ever followed, and I've always enjoyed the game. And I've enjoyed how Major League Baseball has really tried mightily to adapt and change its presentation of the game to the fan base that's used to quicker, more frenetic action. And that was something that Major League Baseball was usually very hesitant to do, but has started to adapt more. I mean, stuff like the fan weekend and where the players had their nicknames on the different colored jerseys. I mean, it's stuff that Major League Baseball is doing to try to adapt to the sporting landscape of the 21st century. And I love that. Now, that said, I think there does still need to be changes in the game. Now, I'm not echoing the idiot, and yes, I'm calling him an idiot. If he wants to come stand toe-to-toe in the Hoodwood, come on. Colin Cowherd, who suggested that the season be cut to 120 games. What is this guy smoking? Wait. If you're cutting it to 120 games, that means you're cutting 25% of the games. And that means the season will end around Labor Day. Now, one, the players' union is never going to sign off from cutting that many games from the season. And two, you're either starting the season late April or early May, or, like I said, ending the season at Labor Day. And last time that happened was 100 years ago, literally 100 years ago, and that was because of World War I. Because Major League Baseball was ordered to close their races by Labor Day and have the World Series in 10 days with only one travel date. But that's neither here nor there. That's not going to happen. They're not going to cut that many games out. Now, I would, however, be okay with 144 to 154 game season with the following provisions. Keep the five playoff qualifiers per league. Keep that set up. But make the wild card round a best of three, not just a one game, you know, win or go home proposition. I mean, you're playing 100 and some odd games to play a one game playoff. That's not going to work. And besides, reward the teams that have made the playoffs with at least one playoff game where they can at least be in front of their fans. Then, of course, the winner would then go on to face the top-seeded team in each league, regardless if it's they're in the same division. Say the Yankees and Red Sox are seeded 1-4. Red Sox win the wild card, then they face the number one team. The number one team should always face the weakest team until they get to the respective league championship and then the World Series. The divisional series would stay a best of five, with the league championships and World Series being best of seven, higher seeded teams having the home field advantage all the way around. So it's not going to be a back and forth NL-AL switching off per year. And of course, thank goodness they've stopped doing the this time it counts for the All-Star game deciding home field advantage, which I thought was one of the stupidest propositions in sports. But instead, have it the best seeded team with record, whoever has a better seeded record, has home field advantage. Don't tell me you can't plan out dates. That's a load of bull. Better record gets home field advantage. If they both have the same record, give it to the higher league seed. So, you know, if they're both number one seeds, then you figure out a way to do like a tiebreak would be like better interleague record or something like that. You have a shorter season, but more playoff games and the playoff races will be even more intense. That's what you want. You want drama-filled pennant races, and then leading up to even more drama-filled playoff series. You want the build-up and the product to make sure that every game counts. I mean, I'm looking at games that are boring, meaningless games in August. And you don't want that. And especially don't want that in September. You want high-stakes games as late in the season as you can get them. Now, I know you can't get rid of interleague play now with uneven number of teams in each league. It facilitates a bull game, as I call it, with an odd team out. But you have to build in a number of interleague games, say 10 to 12, and you have enough interdivisional and intradivisional games to make the numbers work. But the numbers could work. Why can't Major League Baseball sit down with the players' union and put together a comprehensive package that will make the baseball playoffs and the pennant races even more intense? A one-game playoff for the wild card is stupid. You're going to put extra teams in the playoffs? Make the playoffs worth something and worth watching. Now, we'll have a new segment here. It's called Hoodwood's Hot 5 with college football upon us. We'll have three quick hit topics, the game of the week, and then the Hoodwood Top 10, which will be the top 10 teams by my unabashed rankings. I'll put them together every week. And so let's start off with some of the quick hits. Is this a make or break year for Jim Harbaugh at Michigan? Now, they don't have a couple of warm-up games. They face the equally beleaguered Notre Dame with his equally hot-seated coach Brian Kelly this Saturday in South Bend. I think the loser of this game might have some for sale signs out front of the respective house in either South Bend or Ann Arbor. This is a big, big game. Let me give you a player to watch. David Montgomery of Iowa State. He's a running back, as a preseason All-American. And if you've not seen this young man play, you're missing out. You need to get with the program. Now, I have to admit, this is like the disclaimer. I personally know David. I know his mother. And I've seen this young man. He grew up in my old neighborhood. And I've seen this young man grow up to be a fine young man as well as an outstanding player. So he is somebody that you can equally root for on and off the field. He's an alum of my high school, but this young man has real talent. He is, if you find some of the highlights of him running, get a chance, you'll watch him take on Iowa from last year. Guy gets stopped at the 4-yard line, just trucks a couple of hapless Hawkeyes on his way to a score. He is a fun player to watch. If you get a chance to watch him, that's one you need to watch. You want playoff predictions? Okay, you want more. Here's the college football playoff predictions from the Hoodwood. I think this is the first year that Bama does not make the playoff. Doesn't make it. I think Alabama's quarterback situation will do them in. I think Saban got lucky back in January making that switch of quarterbacks to win the title to beat Georgia. But I don't think he can pull it off over a season. I have the following four teams playing for the national title in the college football playoff in January. I have Georgia, Washington, Clemson, and even though I said he was on the hot seat, Michigan in the football Final Four. I know that's going to give me the entire wrath of Ohio State fans. What? You didn't pick Ohio State? I'm just saying. Those are four teams that I'm picking. Now, Hoodwood's game of the week, as much as I want to say Michigan-Notre Dame as game of the week, or my beloved alma mater versus Cincinnati playing at UCLA, I will have to take Miami at LSU. This is a rare, rare Sunday night game. They're not playing Saturday night, which is a long-held tradition in LSU, but they're playing a Sunday night game in Death Valley. The Canes playing in LSU is a rarity. The eighth-ranked Canes might be walking into a trap. LSU is, and when I saw this number, it blew me away. They are 201-59-3. At Death Valley Tiger Stadium at night. I'm not picking against the Bayou Bengals at home at night. I'm not a fool. The pick here is LSU. Now, this week's initial Hoodwood Top 10 reads as follows, even though I haven't picked them for the playoff. Alabama's number one, followed by Georgia, Clemson, Washington, Ohio State, Wisconsin, Oklahoma, West Virginia, Auburn, and Miami. Yes, I know Ohio State is in the top 10, but I don't have them going to the college football playoff. I have Alabama's number one, and I don't have them going to the college football playoff. Things change, people. This is a dynamic and living, breathing top 10 that will be constantly shifting. But we got to start off with an initial preseason top 10. We'll come back with Phat Dap and Head Slap and the final word from the Wood in just a moment.
Nonsense commentary, insight, and opinion on the world of sports. Here now, the man with 100% certified fresh tape, your host, KJ Green.
Rounding third and heading for home here in the Hoodwood. Take a look at the Phat Dap and Head Slap of the week. Now, Phat Dap actually happened last month. I was doing some reading today and came across this notable item. I had to get this out of there. Phat Dap is going to Mitchell Lowen, who's a lineman for the New Orleans Saints. He was having brunch with his family last month when a car crashed out of a parking structure and landed on his roof. Now, that in itself is a scary sight, but Lowen led a group of people in turning the car first onto its side and then right side up and getting the driver out. They extricated the driver even though he did have serious injuries and he was not identified. Lowen didn't even find out the driver's name. He was then rushed to a hospital and he did have serious but not life-threatening injuries. And from what I've read, that the driver was able to survive his injuries and make a recovery. Have you ever seen someone try to turn over a car? I mean, I've seen mob scenes turn over cars before, but to do that in the span of time he did it and help lead the charge for it and get, you know, take charge, take action, and take decisive action to get someone out of a situation like that. You got to give Dap to Lowen for leading the way to save the day. Now, the Head Slap of the Week, I am a person who understands true fandom. You know, I'm a diehard UC, University of Cincinnati alum. I'm passionate about Red Wings and hockey and Minnesota Vikings and football. And I, like I said, I understand true fandom and true passion. That means you go with your team ups and downs, good and bad. You don't sell your fandom. Evan Perlmutter, a supposed Knicks fan, sold his fandom on eBay for $3,450. He sold his fandom for money. Now, I don't. Perlmutter said he's a lifelong Knicks fan, so I don't know who's the bigger lunk, Perlmutter or James Riddle, for buying the tickets. Who spends $3,450 for supposed fandom? That doesn't make any sense. But Perlmutter, who once upon a time worked for Madison Square Garden in the sales and ad sales department, now says he's going to be a Lakers fan and that he is going to be attending a home and an away Lakers game. And he put $500 down in Vegas that the Lakers will improve their win total from last year, which I think is going to be a pretty easy bet to make. The Knicks, for their part, called Perlmutter an attention seeker, and Perlmutter was inundated with hate mail. Me, I feel sorry for the guy. I think he's a front runner. I mean, it's going to be easy to jump on a Lakers bandwagon, though he could have been worse than just jumped on the Warriors bandwagon, but still, if you're a fan of a team, you ride or die with the team. Now, I say this with a caveat. At one time, I did root for the Buffalo Bills. I moved to Minnesota in 97 and was still kind of a Bills fan. Then, staying up there, being inundated with Minnesota stuff, I switched my allegiance. But I didn't quote-unquote sell fandom. I just changed teams because of where I lived. That makes sense. Perlmutter, supposedly a hardcore Knicks fan, sold his fandom. Who sells fandom? Doesn't make any sense. Now, if the Lakers don't win, or if what I'm hoping is that the Knicks have a breakout season, and I'm not wishing no bad or ill will on the Knicks, or the Lakers. I wish no bad or ill will on the Lakers, but it would serve Perlmutter right if they had an also-ran season. And then, if the Knicks have a breakout season, you could just see this guy right back at Madison Square Garden, sitting right next to Spike Lee, rooting for the Knicks. And now, ladies and gentlemen, the final word from the wood. There are fewer and fewer people who remember when the NFL schedule was 14 games. You know, in a 14-game season, if a team won 10 games, they were a legit playoff team. Though with a 14-game season, only four spots, playoff spots, there were times that 10 games got you nothing but a pat on the head and sent home. That's the 1976 Bengals. But the NFL expanded the schedule to 16 games in 1978, the way it's been ever since, and they added a wild card to the playoff landscape and watched the game grow exponentially. In 1990, they added a third wild card and reformatted the playoffs so that winning your division guaranteed you a home playoff game, and the top two teams in the conference got a first-round bye. I love the way they set this up. And with the realignment and shift four divisions in 2002, they reformatted the playoffs, but all the division winners got home games, and the wild cards were reduced, but you all, like I said, again, you had four division winners. Now, the way it is with the four division winners and the two wild cards in each conference, the playoff system, I think, with 16 games in a season, is almost perfect. But now you have Jerry Jones, who is now carping for playoff expansion as well as a schedule expansion to 18 games. Now, also on the flip side, he's also proposing a reduction in preseason games from 4 to 2. The funny thing is when the schedule was increased from 14 to 16 games in 1978, the number of preseason games were reduced from 6 to 4. Can you imagine 6 preseason games now? Oh, you think the game is bad now? It would be just even worse with 6 preseason games. That would just make my stomach turn. But in an 18-game season, 10 wins isn't even playoff caliber. 10 games is barely break even. Be 10-8. Just barely above mediocrity. And getting 1,000 yards rushing in an 18-game season is like walking backward. Anybody can do it. I mean, you put the math together in an 18-game season, 55 yards a game gets you 1,000 yards. That basically means all the heralded, quote-unquote, 1,000-yard rushers would be meaningless. So, and I'd be willing to bet you that the 2,000-yard rushing club, which has only a handful of players, I believe the number is 7, will get way, way, way more crowded. And think about it. O.J. Simpson did a 2,000-yard rushing season in 14 games. He averaged better than 180 yards to do so. And in the season since the 2,000-yard rushing, the last one being Adrian Peterson in 2012, but these rushers had to average a good number of yards every week to get to 2,000. In an 18-game season, they have to barely average over 120 yards. Now, I have no use for preseason games, to be sure. I'm all for the reduction of preseason these useless preseason games. This will make coaches work harder and faster to evaluate talent, or maybe even expand rosters. There's a thought there. While we're on the subject of games, I want to shift the focus a little bit of the final word and scheduling. Let's do away with the weekly Thursday night games, period. I think Thursday night games are useless. The players hate them. The schedules is just always convoluted. They're a nightmare to prepare for on a short week. And they serve, I think, no purpose. I, for one, doing weekly picks, which will start next week, hate trying to write up game previews that fast after a previous week. Monday night game, then you have Tuesday, Wednesday, and then all of a sudden, you're preparing for a Thursday night game. But I digress on that. My proposal is, hear me out on this. Instead of a Thursday night game, continue the Monday night doubleheader. You do a Monday night doubleheader on the first weekend of the season. 7-10 and 10-20. I love that concept. Let's do that every week. Do a 7-10 and a 10-20 game on Monday night every week. And it will be smashing. You have enough Western teams to facilitate that late start. And you can rotate it so that all teams get primetime exposure, especially the ones out west. I have no issue, keep in mind, I have no issue with opening the season on Thursday, you know, getting the champs out front on the Thursday night game. No issue with that, because you have, then you have better than a week to recover from that, because you don't have a game in front of it. And I love that Thanksgiving has three games. I have no issue with that. And I have no issue with Saturday games in December. But the increasing of games and the games on Thursday make no sense. It will mess up the perfect schedule setup with four teams, you know, playing your division three times. I mean, playing your division twice, three games in your division. Playing one division, all four games. And playing the opposite conference division for once each for 16 games. And then a mirror game against three games in whatever place you're in. You're messing up that perfect schedule setup. As it stands right now, every team plays every team in each conference once every 3 years, and every team at least once every four. I know I will see my Vikings play in Cincinnati every 8 years, and they will play the Vikings and Bengals do play every 4 years. You can implement an 18-game schedule. That just messes it up. I think this is nothing short of a naked cash grab by Jerry Jones and a barefaced attempt to keep his Cowboys in playoff contention every year. And that's the final word from the Wood. With the music coming up in the background, you know that means your time in the Hoodwood is just about done. I thank you for your visit this week. And keep in mind, the email is kjgreen@blackbanditproductions.com. You can send me show thoughts, ideas, or topics, praise, and yes, criticism. I am not immune to your criticism, and it makes the show better. And you can catch the podcast weekly on a number of outlets, and I have links to the show site and previous episodes available at hoodwoodsports.podbean.com. You can find cool links, funny videos, and other bonus content there. You can also access the show on your phone now. You can download it App Store for iTunes or on Google Play. I'm on Facebook, Black Banner Productions and Enterprises, Twitter at KJGreen20 and KJGreenB, as well as YouTube, which has audio for the moment. We're producing a video simulcast here very soon. So that's that. Until next week, from the Hoodwood, fellow sports fans, I'm KJ Green.
Sports from the Hoodwood is a Black Bandit Productions and Entertainment.